Hey everybody, welcome to Board Online, Board Offline. Today we are very excited to bring to you our updated best solo games of all time list. Now last year we went to 9. We did our top 9 in 9 minutes. This year we're going to our top 11 in 11 minutes. Whenever I make these lists, I try to always make sure that it's the top 20% at the most. I don't ever want to push out farther than 20%. This year I have played now 57 games. That's 10 more. 10 additional games added to my solo resume from last year. So 57 solo games, we're going to do 11, the top 11 out of that. Now, I do want to mention our sponsor, Board Game Co. This is a fantastic website. You really need to go check them out. This is a great website where you can buy, sell, and trade your way into a better collection because they let you buy games from them. They've got a great stock of games for you to choose from. They let you sell games to them. They have a great system that's really easy to use, very clear to use, lets you know exactly what you'll get for selling a game to them just by going to the website, clicking a few buttons. You can figure it all out. And then also you have the ability to make trades with them. Now, this is a really cool feature because if you go over there and if you have a BoardGameGeek account already, if you have already set up a trade list on BoardGameGeek, what you want in trade, what you have for trade, you go over to BoardGameCo, you type in your BoardGameGeek username, and you do a couple other things there, and then all of a sudden it's got a trade list for you right there on the website built off of your trade list as compared to what they have in stock. Very cool system. Highly recommend you check it out. If you don't have a BoardGameGeek account, no problem. You can still make trades. Just requires a little more legwork on your part. BoardGameCo makes it easy to buy, sell, and trade your way into a better collection. Now, I do also want to mention PubMeeple. PubMeeple is a website that I've been using for years to build my top 10, top 20, top 3 list. And they have a program over there called the Ranking Engine. I don't know if it's a program. I don't know what exactly you call it, but they have a page on their website called the Ranking Engine. And now you can go to that and you can load in all the games you have in your collection and then say, all right, I'm ready to rank. And then you just start clicking, do you like this game better or this game better? Pick one and it goes to the next one. Super easy to use. It makes it very easy for me to put together these top lists that I have every year. So I highly recommend you go over to PubMeeple and check out what they have to offer. The Ranking Engine is not the only thing they have. They have all kinds of cool stuff over there. So be sure to check PubMeeple.com out as well. Okay, without anything else, we're going to get right into the list, starting with number 11. Of course, it's going to be 11 in 11 minutes, so the 11 minutes starts right now. Okay, number 11 was not quite on the list last year. It was number 13. This is Euphoria, Build a Better Dystopia. Now, Euphoria, the base game, is not solo. If you get the expansion, it becomes a solo-capable game. And the expansion is put out by the solo portion of the expansion is put out by the Ultima Factory. And if you know anything about the Ultima Factory, you know this isn't something that's just tacked on. The expansion or the solo version for Euphoria is fantastic. I really, really love this. Euphoria is already a great game where you're trying to basically, etch out a spot for yourself in this dystopian future. There's four different factions, but you're not actually one of the factions. You're kind of, pulling all the factions together. You do have workers that belong to certain factions or helpers or something. And dice are your main workers. But if your dice get too smart, they realize they're in a dystopia and they run away. So you got to be careful with how much knowledge they have. Euphoria is number 11. Number 10 is This War of Mine. It is new to the list. This War of Mine is based off of the app, which is a thoroughly intense, realistic look at what it's like to be a civilian in a caught in the crossfire of a civil war. And in the board game does a very good job of adapting it. The board game, technically speaking, it says it can have multiple players, but really I feel like it was built as a solo game and then they tacked on additional players. It has, you know, this constantly oppressive feel of, you know, how are we going to survive? And be honest, I don't know, because I have not ever survived. I've never beaten This War of Mine, the board game. I've beaten the app like once, maybe twice, I think just once. And it's definitely something, if you're looking, it has like something like several hundred little story blurbs. I can't remember exactly how many. I want to say it's like 400 of them. Definitely check out This War of Mine for a very unique experience in the survival genre of board games. Number 10, This War of Mine. Number 9 is Midara. It was number 6 last year. Midara is a enormous game. It's got a real like anime style to the artwork. It has the campaign book. The story in the campaign book is... I've never seen a game like this where it feels like you're working your way through a novel. The campaign scenario book is 500 pages long because there's some scenarios where you have 10 pages of text of story in between the scenarios. You start with these characters that you technically don't have any classes. You can build the character exactly how you want it from the ground up, have all these different schools of skills and everything. So much equipment in this game. There's so much equipment to choose from in this game. It can be a little overwhelming, to be perfectly honest, but I love it. That is Midara. Number 8 is PAX Emancipation. Number 3 last year. This one fell a little bit, but it's got more to do with what's above it than it does PAX Emancipation itself, even though I did not get it to the table enough over the past year. I need to get this one back to the table more. I've been trying out some other Phil Eklund games, and so far none of them have held up to PAX Emancipation. It takes place when Britain initially started pushing out, making a push for illegalizing slavery worldwide. And there's 3 different factions in the game. When you're playing the solo mode, there's a way at the end of the game for it to become a competitive game because of some historical things that happen. That doesn't happen when you're playing solo. You're just playing through the cooperative portion of it. And you're fighting against the board is a very, very difficult game. The rules themselves are difficult. I do have a how to play video for it, so be sure to check it out if you want to check out PAX Emancipation. But I love this game. It's one of the crunchiest games on this list, without a doubt. Be sure to check it out. Number 8, PAX Emancipation. Number 7 is Root. Root is a game from Leader Games where there is all-out warfare in the woodland realm. And you have the cats and the birds and all the creatures that are kind of, you know, the Woodland Alliance, which are all the other creatures that are kind of dealing with this warfare between the two of them. And there's a vagabond that's running around. I have an expansion that I have not played yet. I've got to get it to the table. The expansion looks so cool. All the different factions have very, very different abilities and powers. It is incredibly asymmetrical. It's sort of, I would say it is a coin game, counterinsurgency style game, where every faction has very, very different rule sets and ways to play and also ways to win. Even though in Root, you're trying to get to a certain number of points to win the game. Number 6 is Seventh Continent. Root, by the way, last year was number 9. Seventh Continent last year was number 4. I don't think it made it into the frame here, but it is set up on the table right now. I'm currently playing through one of the curses. In Seventh Continent, there's multiple curses. I believe there's 4 in the base game. Multiple curses that you choose from. Generally choose one at a time, and that sets up the scenario. But the Seventh Continent itself is a fixed terrain. It's not randomized. Once you know the terrain, that is how you're going to make your way around the island to lift these curses off of you. As you're going through this deck right here is your action deck, or like you're drawing these cards and building things with them. But at the same time, that's also your life. And so you're making all these tough choices about what you're going to use, what needs to go back in the deck to try to refresh it. Once you get, you know, once it becomes, it goes into the discard pile, then you're going to end up, if you run out of the action deck, then you got to start drawing from the discard pile. If you draw a curse card from the discard pile, you lose. Lots of great choices in this game. And the terrain itself has such a fantastic exploration feel to it. I love it. That's number six, Seventh Continent. Number five is Kingdom Death Monster, which is my number one game of all time when playing with other people. Playing solo, I still absolutely love it, which I'll tell you more about these next four. Kingdom Death Monster is just this horrific hellscape where you're playing four survivors at a time who are trying to fight these different monsters, harvest them for parts so you can then make armor and weapons and take their organs and grind it up into monster grease to make yourself more difficult to hit. And the stories that emerge from this, there's no real like cohesive through line for the story. There is a little bit, but really the stories that emerge from this are just remarkable from the random events that they are random, but they somehow seem to not be as you work your way through each campaign. That's Kingdom Death Monster number five. Number four is Cloud Spire, new to my list. Kingdom Death Monster was number five last year as well. Cloud Spire is new to my list. Cloud Spire is this really, really cool game. Tower defense style game where you got, you know, the AI is sending waves of guys at you. You're sending waves of guys at them. The components in this game are absolutely stunning. There are so many special abilities in this game, which some people complain about, but I really love the fact that there is just ability after ability. I mean, they give you player aids for each faction. And so I guess, you know, you could say, well, if I really want to play this to the best, I got to know all the abilities of the other faction too. Well, I'm just playing to have a good time. And when those abilities are relevant, I'll know what they do. But in the meantime, I know what my abilities are. And it's just such a gorgeous game with so many cool concepts and cool abilities and cool factions. That's Cloud Spire number four. Number three is Tainted Grail. This one is new to my list. I just finished the campaign for Tainted Grail. Fantastic story. Dark take on the Arthurian legend. You're running around, you're doing all kinds of questing. You are not the hero. You are like the third or fourth string because everybody else is dead. And this stuff called the weirdness is seeping into Avalon, taking Avalon back over because Arthur had beaten the weirdness back. And you're trying to figure out what's going on. How can you save your people before the weirdness completely takes over? Tainted Grail is just such a fantastic, sometimes very frustrating game because it's in that old school style of adventure games where they don't tell you exactly where you got to go. They give you hints and you better figure it out. Kind of like Seventh Continent. Number two is Mage Knight, which was number two last year as well. Mage Knight is the quintessential solo game for many people. And as you can see, it's damn near the top for me as well. Mage Knight is such a, I believe is the first really, really crunchy solo game I got my hands on too. Might be crunchier even than Pax Emancipation. Mage Knight, you are a Mage Knight that is going through the land. There's gonna be two cities you're trying to get to and you're gonna conquer these two cities is the goal. How often you actually successfully conquer them both, who knows, because it's very seldom for me. But there's a deck building aspect, but it's like a slow build on the deck building because you only get a few extra cards a day, and there's only usually 3 days in the game, 3 days and three nights. But Mage Knight is fantastic. And number one is Gloomhaven. Gloomhaven was number one last year. These two are always a tough, you know, for me to figure out which one's one, which one's two. But so far, Gloomhaven has had it for the past couple of years at least. And Gloomhaven is a game all about card play. There's no dice. You have a deck of attack modifier cards that you draw from whenever you attack something. And there's some bad stuff that can happen with that. But as your character levels up, you then get to modify that attack modifier deck and take stuff in, put stuff out. Meanwhile, you have a hand of cards, and each card has two sets of actions on it, one at the top, one at the bottom of the card. On your turn, you play two cards, and you choose the action on the top of one and the action on the bottom of the other. And sometimes, depending on how powerful it is, you'll actually have to burn that card. It'll be gone for the rest of the scenario. Most of the time, they end up in your discard pile. There's all kinds of, you know, cool abilities and effects, and there's like 90 something scenarios, and that is my timer. Gloomhaven is just so thrilling. Now that I've gotten done with Tainted Grail, that campaign, and I'm gonna work through each of the curses for Seventh Continent, I've got two more to go after this. I'm going to start working on my Gloomhaven campaign because I've got to get through that before Frosthaven gets here, because I've backed that as well, which is the sequel to Gloomhaven. I also have Gloomhaven Jaws of the Lion, which is the prequel and is a fantastic place to start if you look at Gloomhaven's components and feel like, hey, that's a bit too much. Not an uncommon feeling for people when they're looking at Gloomhaven, for sure. There we go. That is my top 11 best solo games of all time of 2020, the updated 2020 list. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please be sure to give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, check out all the other great videos I've got going on here. Be sure to stick around. I have a new segment I've just started. It's going to be coming out. The plan is weekly. I'm going to be putting out a segment called Online Relapse. I have been almost completely out of video games for I'd say about 6 years at this point, and I have pre-ordered the Xbox, the new Xbox Series S, and I'm going to be getting back into video gaming. So there's a lot of cool stuff I'm excited about there. I'm going to just a little extra added thing to the channel here, so be sure to check that out. I've started throwing some Online Relapses out with XCOM, an old game, a few years old, XCOM Enemy Within on the phone. I'm just right there on my iPhone playing it, sharing it with you. I'm having a good time revisiting XCOM Enemy Within because it's been a few years since I played that. That's pretty much the only video game I've played since I quit playing the Xbox 360. I skipped an entire generation of video games. So getting into this next generation is going to, no matter even the beginning games of the generation are still going to feel super futuristic for me because I didn't play video games for an entire generation. Thanks for watching again. And until next time, if you're bored online, bored offline.